Welcome to the final session. We've had the whole day of talking. One big announcement we made for those who were not there for the last session, that we finally have an opening film for Jagran Film Festival. It's called A Star is Born. Stars Lady Gaga is going to sweep the Oscars in 2019, and you'll watch it for the first time in India on the 27th of this month, on the first day of Jagran Film Festival here in Bombay. So I hope, Ekta, to see you there as well. That's a movie that everyone's talking about. Yes. We had a long introduction for you, yes. But the way I have known you as a viewer is the way I've known a gentleman called Sergey Bubka. I have never watched Pole Vault, okay? Not too many people in the world have watched Pole Vault. But everybody knows Sergey Bubka. There's one person they all know because he became almost as big as that sport. I don't know the crowd here, but in general, a lot of my friends may not have watched all your TV shows. But there is not one person we know who hasn't heard of Ekta Kapoor. You're almost as big as the medium, a cultural phenomenon by yourself. Question to you is, how did that happen?
So when you said that you're almost as big, I was really checking my weight for 5 seconds. I don't think the keto is helping. But I don't know, you know, I do my job and I think a lot of things are byproducts. So when I started off with television because my father told me that you can't sit at home. So either you get married or start working. Marriage was not an option. So I started working because he was like, I can't see you partying every night and doing what every youngster does who has a lot of means and a lot of financial ease in their life. And he says that ease cannot become the reason or a curse. It can't be a blessing that is a curse, you know. You have to work and earn your living or do something on your own. Which is quite an emancipated thought for a Punjabi papa, but yeah. And so I started working and then he came to me with his offer that a friend of his had told him to make content for a channel in London. So to cut the long story short, that content was made but the channel got sold and the content was so bad no one bought it. Mm. And let me tell you, most of it was, according to me, revolutionary television. Which everyone said that, what are you doing? I mean, who's going to watch this at home? Luckily, I got a show of mine, which I made with the last bit of money called Hum Panch. And then I started Balaji Telefilms. And everything else after that was...
The rest is history, isn't it?
I don't know if the rest is history, but the rest is definitely folklore.
Well, it's folklore, it's history also, because the years that you've been in the space has also been the years where we've moved from film to television to OTT, and you've actually been in all three platforms, or all three media, as it were. But what I find most intriguing about you, Ekta, speaking of partying and stuff, you are, and I don't know how many people know this, but they probably do, because if they read, you know, they see pictures and stuff, you are the best host in Bombay. You throw the best parties there are. You're single, you are fun, you are very urbane also, very Juhu girl, Mitti Bhai girl. And then you come up with what would be the Sati Savitri woman, the Parvati woman, the, you know, Sindoor woman. What was your inroad to that world? How did you learn that? To even tap into that market, which is, I would imagine, at least looking at you, would be very divorced from the world you come from. What did you do to actually tap into that market?
I think I'll answer the first part first, which is...
Which is to invite me to your next party.
Yeah, of course. Okay. Yeah, I always invited you. You've come rarely. So that's another one we'll take offline. But no, the party bit, no. I was saying about how are you so different from these women? And I'm like, we are as different as we are similar or alike. Mm-hmm. Because I believe that there's this world out there that starts looking at a different kind of person cagely, which I have learned to move away from. Acceptance should be the biggest word that we learn. We have failed as a generation to learn the word acceptance. I mean, a woman who wears a sari, who has a different thought process, who wears loads of jewelry, who probably lives a different life, deserves that much respect and insight. And I think I just did that. I think I have as much fun making a nagin without losing respect for the job I do, as I have promoting or making a lipstick.
Mm.
And I think that's because we all have different sides to us. When I'm doing Nagin, I believe that folklore should be enjoyed, reveled. I mean, it's suspension of reality. It's absolute unabashed entertainment for the masses. And I respect the masses. So I do it with full aplomb. And then when you do something which you think is interesting, thought-provoking, you do that with that thought process. I mean, it's like, I think we have those sides to us, but we are cagey to accept a different thought because we think we are a certain kind of person. And how did I get into this? Yes, when I was young, I didn't live in a new joint family, but I realized the content I was making wasn't going into television because it was different. It was like a little clutter breaking. I decided to make shows on peer pressure and really like... And none of it was getting approved. And I was like, what am I doing?
Mm.
I wanted to do drama. And I realized Indian families sit and eat together. And we as a nation, hamare khane ke daant aur dikhane ke daant aur hote hain. So what we watch with our parents is going to be very different than what we watch alone.
Mm.
And that's how I decided to realign my thought process and made large, unabashed family dramas.
And you almost also killed the entire genre that exists in cinema, for instance. Like, Hum Aapke Kaun would become redundant once you do kitchen politics on television. Is that what happened?
No, I think experiences change. So films have to live up to the experience that they promise, which is communal viewing. If I'm going with five friends to a theater or with my family to a theater, I need to see what is promised. And I think if that promise is being delivered by delivered by TV, I have to just change the promise. So I don't think I killed a genre. I think I somewhere compromised it a bit, but it could have, it then, what should I say, it metamorphosized into something else and came back.
Right. But you know, you've said this in the past, and I think you've said it's quite often, is that when it comes to content on television, while it allows for progressive content, it does not allow for radical content.
Absolutely.
What do you mean by that?
So progressive content is that you can have, we should say, larger thought processes which are progressive taken into consideration, like women working, yes. I mean, women supporting NGOs, women having a stay at home, which at one time was a struggle for women. So it's gotten progressive. You have a story now, I mean, I have not made it, somebody's made it, called Shakti, which is the first transgender show. And it has worked. That means people are interested in watching even something like transgender, which I don't think any film has done or digital show has done.
Right.
I mean, just now, I mean, their Sacred Games has done, but it was television did 3 years ago.
Right.
And there are...
But Sacred Games is also not theatrical. It's,
yeah,
it is still...
I'm saying it's still... Right. But, but television, like typical Indian television did it 3 years ago. We did a show which was about a woman who is in Indian... In our society called barren, if she can't have a child, and you know, reproduction cannot be the reason you're called incomplete.
Mm.
So we did a show, and it was a non-primetime show, but it took off and it became India's cult show. And India accepted her and accepted that motherhood is nurturing, not nature. And I was in shock because I was like, this is a really big one. Because a year before that, when I had shown a woman who's in a bad marriage, having an issue with her husband who's cheated on her, finally deciding to have an emotional bond with a colleague, it became an issue because they said, "Marta to nahi hai na, to problem kya hui?" So that's radical. A woman and her sexuality in India is radical. But her career choices, her going ahead and doing something for her family, over her in-laws, taking a stand for herself is progressive. So where the progressive gets a little radical, they get skirmish.
Now, when you take television onto an OTT platform, which is not where everyone has to watch it together, does that liberate you as a person who can do radical plus progressive or whatever it is that you want to do?
I feel I'm in a candy store, you know. I mean, people are like, how are you going to manage with all the international players coming in? I'm like, the process is so much fun because in films, I had to actually wait for actors' dates. I did very small films, if you saw, because I couldn't have that, you know, and I was not used to that mindset of actually getting having dinners, getting to know actors. I mean, now it's a very different, but it was sort of a trend. I didn't know anyone personally.
But contrary, you're from a film family. I mean,
yeah, contrary to the fact that right. I'm a film family, I spent a lot of time doing television and I lost touch with everyone. But I did films which I actually thought was, this is a relief for me because these are nothing that is expected from me. With digital, I get a space which is far more individualistic. So like, I believe film is communal viewing, TV is family viewing, and individual viewing is digital. I don't have to cater to something that everybody likes. I don't have to make a one size fits all. And I can finally tell stories that I want to tell, and some of it is really like, you know, even a fun, stupid show is fun because it doesn't get you shackled into a thing that, oh, will this be accepted?
So you're saying when television has to deliver to, say, 150 million homes or 150 million people, that's the number which is, you know, way higher than what films need to do, which is roughly around 3 million.
I remember, it's 150 million homes. It's not 150 million people.
Wow.
And 150 million homes means you adopt what I call the home personality. A lot of us, including me, and I'm guilty to say this, will not be comfortable watching a highly sexual scene with my dad in the room. Like, I'd be like, I have no problems. You watch it on your own, and I'll watch it on my own. And it's just the way we are as Indians, maybe, you know. And therefore, TV is, you're going into someone's home. It's like, I don't know which culture, which lifestyle, which mindset I'm getting into. There's a child there's a mother there's a grandmother there. There are girls there, so you're so careful. And it's almost vanilla, the kind of content you do on TV. And yet you have to get them back every week. So it's like going for a war with your hands and legs tied. On an OTT platform, you have an open space. You know that you're catering to a certain kind of viewer. You know that they have the sensibility to see the promo and watch it alone or with their friends. And they don't have to then. So you have the ability to make content because you know that then the discretion is of the viewer.
But how did you get into the mindset of homes which are so disparate from yours? And when you're talking about such huge numbers, did you use research? Did you use metrics? Did you do surveys?
I never do research. I believe in instinct and one thing which is called, a lot of us have it in us, which is called experience. I mean, I do the same job so many times that at some point I get to know my viewer. And it's an instinct that gets sharpened by experience, you know. So, I mean, I don't do research because I believe research is postmortem. They will find an old show and say, this is what the research said. But I rather go with instinct. I actually believe you have to know that what the viewer is not saying and would probably want. So, research will never tell you that.
So, Nagin was instinct?
Yeah, it was.
It came in your dream?
It came in my dream. Actually, I wanted to make it after Dhoti picture, by the way.
Oh, really?
I really wanted to. I think I went to a very big actress and I told her, I want to make Nagin. She said, India's going to watch Nagin. Like, are you like for real? I said, yeah. But are you serious? India's going to watch Nagin? I said, I'm telling you, India will watch Nagin. India loves folklore. It has never seen its own folklore on celluloid. I mean, after years.
Right, right. The genre almost like became non-existent in cinema.
Yeah, celluloid. But it, I said, well, then when I got this no one, I was like, I'm not going to go and convince people. I said, I'll make it a TV show. And I went to Colors. I said, I want to make Nagin. They said, okay. Yeah, go make it. I said, fine, let's go and make it. And it happened.
That's because they love you, right? I mean, yeah, you do something, it becomes success.
I don't know if they love me. But I just thought that India should just, I mean, we have folklore in our country. And I don't want to run away from it or get shy about it. It's pretty interesting. We have our own shapeshifters. We have our own Draculas. And they call Nagins.
But for you, as personally, as a creative person, Ekta, you've grown up with your father, his cinema.
That's why I watched Nagin. He was in Nagin.
So that's what I was getting at. Was there a huge influence of the stuff he did in the 80s in your television as well?
Yeah. A lot of influence of his 80s movies. A lot of influence of a lot of things I saw in the 80s. Of course, my favorite movies were Ramses. I think I watch all of them. But I think, yeah, I think a lot of movies, not only my dad's, but Mr. Bachchan's in the 80s influenced my mindset. And I thought that's what the masses will always want.
Did you love the 80s Bollywood?
Not really. I think I preferred the 90s and the Adi Chopra era. But right. Yeah, I didn't mind it, you know.
Right. But the reason why I'm asking this question is also because when you do television, when you have to appeal to that many people, which is very different from what you'll do or what you are doing in OTT, because these are the early adopters of the medium.
Yeah.
They're using it right now. And of course, it'll have that depth and it'll get that reach eventually. It's a matter of time. There's stuff that you've done on television which you can easily adapt to OTT because this OTT crowd has not seen yourself. Is there a temptation to remodel what you've done for a new audience?
I think yeah and no also. I have so much I have not done because I couldn't do it on TV that I actually want to do that first. But yeah, if there's a great story that I can remodel, and like Manmarzia was a great example. They took an very quintessential and did it in today's context. So I'd love to do that. But at this present moment, there are many stories to be told which I'm dying to tell.
How many stories are you dying to tell? Okay, at any point in time, how many shows of yours or how many things, whether they're shows on OTT, TV, perhaps even films, are in pre-production, in production or in post? At any point in time.
So I have about 30 shows on the OTT platform that I'm working on.
30 shows right now,
five
as we
films
speak.
And about 10 dailies on air at this moment.
Guys, I'm sorry. What did you do today? How many hours did you work? Are you a workaholic? Do you work 20 hours a day?
I'm actually, you know, I don't have many hobbies. I started working when I was 17. So I look at people who say, like, when we go for a holiday, you know, it's like, don't you want a holiday? I don't know anything else. I was a couch potato before that. I only watched television. That was my enjoyment, which is clearly killed because now I can't watch television for enjoyment. I mean...
Yeah, but you're a Narcos fan.
I'm a Narcos fan. I'm actually, at this present moment, indulging in a lot of The Fall. I think it's a fantastic show that I just caught up with.
The reason why I know you're a Narcos fan is because I read a quote of yours where you said, on your OTT platform, you want to go from Nagin to Narcos. I think it's a fantastic line. Is that what you're going to do?
See, I think with individualistic taste, we have a world out there. Everyone is going to have their own kind of entertainment. Their own mobile is going to decide what they want to watch. And they might want to watch both, Nagin and Narcos. Or they might want to watch what is the world between Nagin and Narcos. And they might want to watch a really cheesy soap opera. And they might want to watch a really thrilling, edge of the seat thriller. And that's the choice you will have to watch what you want. So I think it's a world out there. And it is going to skim from Nagin to Narcos.
But tell me something, maybe 8-9 years ago, not even that far back, perhaps even less than that, you would pay, say, 150 rupees and get a cable connection and you could watch everything. Now, there is Netflix, there is Amazon, there is Alt Balaji, there is Z5, there is Eros, there is Disney that's coming up with this app. Technically speaking, how much do you think a person can actually invest in their monthly entertainment? Do you think there'll be a shakeout with so many players in the market?
Of course there'll be a shakeout, but let's not talk about the financial investment because that everyone will realign as and when they realize the economics of the game. Let's say a lot of people watch, say, Sacred Games. The first question you ask them, they would say they watched it in a night or maximum a weekend. That gives any maker a lot of relief because there are 52 weekends left. And this is one viewer who will need 52 shows on if he or she only watches shows on the weekend. And like that, there'll be different tastes and different viewers. Now you're talking about five players who even if they work day and night will make 25 shows or 30 or 40 shows at max. Do the math. We're talking about 500 million mobile users, five platforms, which will probably at the max make about 200 shows, and yet variety entertainment for 500 million people with smartphones.
But that's another thing, right? I mean, the other aspect of television content as we know it now, I mean television content on, or web series as they call it, is the binge watching aspect of it.
Yeah.
I mean, we were always made to believe that actually audiences have very low attention spans.
Yeah.
But here we are watching, you know, so don't make a 3-hour movie, it's too long, or 3.5 becomes too long, and then we need to shorten it.
But it's actually not to do with the amount of time you'll spend, it's about how much time you'll spend at your convenience. Convenience is the key word here.
Mm.
You're at home, in your bed, you'll watch 2 hours if you want, if it's interesting, you'll watch 5. But when you're in a theater, you have to travel to the theater, you have to spend those 3 hours there, sitting on that chair, and then walk out only when the movie's over. So this convenience that it gives you is the choice that you have now.
You know, you've said this before, and I'd like you to elaborate on this, is that 2016 was a turning point in your life. You were extremely depressed. So far as your film business was concerned, because you had back-to-back films that did not do commercially well. And was there a moment of epiphany where you realized, was this movie thing needs to be re-looked at? And then you actually shut it down.
I think it happens to all of us. It happened to me in 2008. I think it's an 8-year cycle. I had 35 shows out of 50, and then suddenly I was out of top 50 shows. For someone who has worked every day of their life to have 1 year of no work. So how much can you sit on concepts, keep people in the office and say you're working, but actually you have no work? So I've had that happen in 2008.
So what happened in 2008? Exactly.
I just suddenly lost flavor with the channels. My shows became redundant and I was told that I lost the touch. So I have to reinvent.
So were the ratings falling down?
Actually, the systems changed. Now, like there's Bark, there was another system and that changed and went into smaller towns where cable connections were new. So the old shows who were going on for 4 years were no longer being watched because they couldn't catch up with the story. So many reasons, but basically I lost flavor and I was out of favor and I was clearly told that I don't know television anymore and I had to work and create and recreate and rework and realign. 2016 was sad because the two films that were theatre dependent, where you don't have any pre-sales, both one didn't do well and the other one got leaked. And that caused me a lot of losses. Because
Which one are you talking about?
Grand Masti and Urta Punjab got leaked.
But Grand Masti did well, right?
No, it didn't.
Oh, didn't, okay.
It didn't because it was out on people's mobiles 40 days before the release. So I lost all the money I had made and I make very sensibly, I make money on TV. If anyone knows, we save on every episode and suddenly in one movie it was all gone. And so that made me realize that you can have a bad year, but it never really took away my beliefs because I of course I had to go through various boards and sit on that board table and speak about the fact that I promised never to make films because I clearly don't know how to make films. But I said the same thing in 2008 and you really will have those years again where you think you can't do your job well, but that doesn't mean you don't do your job. You keep doing it. You show up at work every day and one day hope for the tide to change.
Was that the point where you took the decision to start Alt Balaji?
No, I decided that in 2015. 2016 came as a big bummer because I couldn't raise funds because of the fact that the films had not done well. But yeah, I decided in 2015 with Sameer sir that we'll start an OTT platform, yeah.
But as a person, you've headed this conglomerate, as we'd call it, a huge empire, television empire. We see people walk outside your building and it's half a temple to begin with. So I can imagine why everyone is praying before they go.
There is a temple inside.
There is a temple, right? There's an actual temple out there. Now, and you've been your own boss since you were 17. You were running your own company since you were in your teenagers. Now, when you take your platform and you have an investor like Mukesh Ambani, who is invested in everything in India, does that change things for you?
You're talking about a man who I have admired for years.
Mm.
He's super intelligent, super humble, and probably knows this, is a visionary, which I think, whenever I met him, I've tried to pick his brains to know exactly what's going to happen in the next 5 years and how the landscape will change and everything. Things change in a way that you suddenly get that person who you've admired believing in you and saying, listen, go ahead and do whatever content you want, we're with you. So that really, really came as a big help.
He didn't send his auditors to check what's going on or even creatively audit your work?
No.
It's just, you're on your own still, like pretty much your own boss?
I'm pretty much my own boss. I get a lot of help. I have a great team, which whenever they need any help from Mr. Modi provides it to us. And you're talking about, I mean, Mukesh Ambani, who I personally think, when I met him, he told me, he said, just do what you're doing and don't bother with anything. Your content will work. You just go ahead and make it. So I'm quite pretty happy. I'm a happy puppy.
You are, you are. I mean, so when you look back at your career, and it's been, while in terms of years, it may not be so much, but in terms of the output, quite clearly, even right now, you're like dealing with 50 things at the same time. What would you consider as the highest point of your life? I mean, for us, as people who followed you and, you know, you enter our imagination at some point, it was when you were doing Kyoki Saas Bhi Kahi Bahu Thi, in the sense of how big it was, like a national phenomenon sort that we'd never seen before, and certainly not in television. Would you consider that your high point?
Definitely. It was my first high point. So it's also very, very big. It was when I actually had begged every channel to give me a drama. It's funny because they said, you're very good in comedy. Just do comedy, na? I was like, I want to do drama. I swear I can do drama. I know it's quite funny that no one believed me at that time. But yeah, so when Kyonki happened and it did so well, I was like, I couldn't believe, and I was just about 24. So for me, it was like, shit, people have taken me seriously. People are looking at me differently. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. That was quite fun.
And that's how you met Smriti Irani.
Yeah.
Now she's the cabinet minister. That's a crazy, that's another, like, how did you guys meet? I mean, from that show to now one of the most powerful people in India. That's a pretty big leap.
Smriti is unbelievable. When I'm talking to her, we are discussing weight loss, keto. Both of us are never going on diets. And I don't think I've ever discussed politics with her. I mean...
Did you see that coming though?
Yeah, she was always interested. She said, you know, I want to do something for the country and stuff like that. And I remember once I went with her to a temple and I realized how big she was, because outside there were millions of people who had believed every word. And she was like, I'm going to do something for the country. So I knew that she was interested. But I'm not interested in politics. So I never ask questions like, you know what? Like, I was like, you know what? Are you joining BJP? Like, and that time Congress was in power. I'm like, really? Like, don't you think you should join Congress? She's like, no, I want to join BJP. I said, okay, cool. That's all I asked her. And then when she was being sworn in, before that I wanted to do Kyonki again with her. And she said, you know what? I'll do it if you want. I said, yeah, but I can't. I have a job here. So I said, you know what? And then suddenly I hear that she's become, and she called me up, she said, I can't do Kyonki. I said, I just saw you've been sworn in. I was like, oh God. So it was interesting, but she's not changed at all. Like, I still, my conversations with her, people can't believe. You know, when she became the INB minister, the first thing I called up her up and said, I said, oh my God. She said, why? I said, I can never call you up about and whine about movies anymore. Because that door has shut for me. And I won't do it because it'll compromise you or me. I got so many calls at that time. And I used to tell people, I said, you know what? She's a friend. I can't make this call.
Right.
So you do it yourself. Or nobody, you know her. Just tell her now to see this film. I said, I can't. It's just not, don't compromise me in this situation. And we would be like, let's discuss diets. Because now we can't even discuss the films we like.
What about Vidya Balan? I mean, you cast her in Hum Paanch back in the day. Did you see that coming, that journey that she took thereafter?
Vidya is very funny. Vidya did Hum Paanch, after which I used to see her in Siddhi Vinayak. And every time I asked her, what are you doing? She said, I'm studying. I was like, how many years are you studying? She would be studying all the time, every year. Now I'm going to do one more degree. I'm like, oh, one more degree. I said, wow. I can't even spell those degrees that you've done. And then one day she told me, I'm becoming an actress. I said, thank God. I'm doing a movie. I said, very good. Then again, we worked together in Dirty Picture.
Dirty Picture, of course, of course. But in that sense, the number of people that you would have launched through your shows, I mean, I'm sure you don't even remember most of the people who starred, and then given the number of them that you've done on television, and then of course you've done films too, and then OTT now. It's a whole industry that you created, what is now called the TV industry, which is a TV type. They've also been typecast in a certain way. Oh, he's a TV type of person. Was genuinely created by you.
Until now you were complimenting me. Now
it's a competition industry.
No, this TV type of person I have not created, I swear.
But you know what I mean.
Versova like, has created.
Well, they live in Versova, but they all work for you.
Okay.
Oh, they have.
I'm going to keep shut at this moment because I'll be sounding politically incorrect.
Are there any interesting people that you remember who you met, who you cast, and then you saw them go their own ways in terms of how big they became?
So this guy, he was always quirky in meetings and he sit in front of me and one day he said, ma'am, do you believe in Krishna? I said, yeah. He took a like a wire and he turned it around and said, here, ma'am. So I'm like, what's this? And he said, this is Krishna. So I said, really? And he said, yeah, Krishna's in any form, na? And I looked at his face and I said, what's your name? And he's like, Anand Gandhi. And I was like, I don't know where he will be, but he'll be somewhere one day. And he made Ship of Thesis.
Right.
I really, I don't want to say much, but he was an interesting person. I remember him quite clearly.
Any others you can remember?
So all of them who've done well, of course you remember. You remember all the actors who've done decently well in life and are now big. But yeah, there are some not so successful ones also you remember because you've landed up becoming friends with them, but I don't want to take their name because then it's like...
Sure. No, that's another thing, right? If we're talking about Versova and it is primarily seen as a film industry place where people are aspiring to be in films. Do you think essentially they've used television as a stepping stone because there is a belief that when you look at someone on TV, you only remember the character. The actor never becomes big. Is that a myth?
I think it's a myth, but it's a myth that needs to be broken by talent and by actors also, I think, should take a little bit of risk. TV usually is taken on by most actors who, after some time, stop innovating in their own roles and they become so happy with the character that they're playing that after a couple of years, when the show ends, they feel that they've made enough money, now I'll do something similar. So I think it's got to be a two-way street. I mean, we do not get to see actors anymore that get to do different roles. I mean, you see Mona, she's done Jussi, now she's done Ye Meri Family, she's done Keneko. So she's taken that initiative to do different roles. You see Sakshi's done stuff like that, she's done Dangal. But a lot of others don't really take that initiative, yeah. So I think they want to be stuck in a cocoon, you know, comfort zone is a great place, but nothing grows there.
Do you think they also get so used to you? I mean, a lot of them actually also petrified of you.
I'm not only making all the shows, as you made me sound like they get used to me. No, nobody's used to me.
But you also petrify them, right?
Of course.
Huh?
You're
supposed to be a scary boss.
Very, very.
The monster boss.
Of course. I'm going to shapeshift into Nagin in any minute now. And dasso you.
Hey, come on now. I've been, what the hell? My point was, do you...
So I actually have a problem when people call me a scary boss.
Okay.
You know why?
Hmm.
So I used to be, I thought, a passionate producer.
Hmm.
Of course, I would lose my temper. And of course, I would expect perfection. But you would never have fingers pointed at a man who would do the same. Aggression on a set with directors is a very known thing.
Mm.
And they get away with it even if they like lose their temper, some of them even abuse. Mm. Because you're a guy and it's taken in your personality, but a woman who sits on a chair and gets a job done, I mean, I wanted to ask people after them, how am I supposed to ask for an episode like this? Can I have my episode, please? Now, please. I mean, how?
Right.
I was no nonsense. I was firm. I was stern. And for a lot of people, it was like, "Arey yar, kitni aggressive hai? To hoon yar." I mean, I don't have to be delicate all the time, do I?
No. I'm scared.
Good, you should be.
But that's not true, Ekta. You know, there are these stories about guy bosses too, and you know, people are petrified of them. Like Vidhu Vinod Chopra famously, like, you know, bit into somebody's hand and stuff like that.
But you know, I've never been into anything.
No, you haven't, right?
My teeth are very soft that way. But yeah, but you've never heard folklore of Vidhu Vinod the way you heard of me. Because I was the first woman sitting in a job which was of extreme pressure, and I was expected to perform, and happily so. And of course, there were times I lost my temper. I'm far more cooler now. But I was far more, I personally feel, having to deal with a far more harsher perspective because, and I'm not playing any card here, but it is a fact.
It is about work, right?
It is a fact. We definitely are not capable of taking women who don't have a delicate stand to everything, because it's expected of us to have that. And it was, aggression is not a accepted quality. And I'm sorry, it's not about, it's, I'm not trying to play or say something, but this is something that women go through a lot. And I have a lot of, like recently it happened with, I mean, I don't want to take names. So it's okay.
Well, you can still tell us a story.
A sports woman who broke a racket, and of course she lost her temper. And we clearly went racist and gender specific on her. And it was wrong, because I mean, aggression we've seen a lot. And
sure. You mean Serena Williams, yes.
I didn't want to say that.
Ali, she's not going to respond to you from there.
But so what? I don't want to say it.
The boss lady of television. Questions from the audience?
Hi, Jyoti.
You want to take the mic, Jyoti?
You know, recently I went to an old Balaji party for XXX where I was disappointed that you didn't turn up for the party.
Yeah.
The question is not that, but whether you made that as a film, but because of the sensor problems and you couldn't get a slot, that's why you converted conveniently it into a old Balaji series.
This is a convenience I have with me. What I can't make into a TV show, I can make into a web show. What I can't make into a web show, I make into a movie. So yeah, that I did. But yeah, it was pretty bold, and I didn't want to go through the censor rigmarole. So I did definitely launch it as a web show.
And in future, how are you going to dabble with all web series, TV serials, feature films and whatnot are going to come?
This is my fun space. I love stories. And the story decides which medium it wants to go to. So, I'll have fun doing them and then we'll decide the medium later.
And also, you're planning to go to
another
Hollywood
party?
Yeah, I'm dressed. Shouldn't I?
You know, speaking of XXX, and there's a reason why we didn't discuss the censorship aspect of it, because the more you discuss it, some nutcase will have a problem and, screw up the medium.
Actually,
yeah,
I'm very worried about
it. But can I ask you a question? In that XXX, is there actually, there's actually a person whose penis talks to him?
Yeah.
Oh, there is. Okay.
So there's a talking penis in XXX, and at the end, this woman he meets, whose vagina talks back.
Hi, Ekta, towards the back. Hi, this is Priyanka. Ekta, I wanted to know that when you made foray into films, did you feel that the image that your TV shows had created for you, people did not take you seriously as a film producer?
So yeah, so when I first made drama, I actually got a chance by a South channel. No, Hindi channel gave me a chance. So when I got into films, I knew I have the ability to understand how people are perceiving me. Ye saas bahu banati hai, isko to kuch aata nahi hoga. So when I met Dibankar, I said, just give me your most quirky film. And he said, no one will back it. Because you know what, I don't want to, I said, just make me hear it. And I heard, I said, I love it. I want to do it. He said, how will you work out the finances? Because no one will buy it. I said, I'll do it on my own. But this is the film I want to, because I knew it that at any point of time, if I didn't want to go into a large family film, because it would look an extension of what I was doing on television, and that's something I didn't want to do.
I think what you'll end up doing, Ekta, eventually, and of course you have a long career ahead, is when we look at your work from film to television and OTT now, it'll be impossible to tell there's one person behind all of this. Whether it's an LSD, it's a show in the city, it's a lipstick under my burqa, it's a kahani ghar ghar ki, you know, kyunki saas bhi bahu thi, the talking penis, it's impossible to tell there is the same person. I mean, you are clearly like multiple personalities in one.
Yeah.
Have you seen a shrink?
I think,
just kidding.
Yeah, I think I should. I like Anupam was me. You know, you're almost, it's almost schizophrenic to meet you. I mean, I can't discuss your content in the same breath, but I think that's all of us. We all have different personalities. I just get a chance to express through my different personalities by making different kinds of content.
Well taken. Yes, that side, please.
Hi Ekta, Ravi from
Ravi
from ABP News. Ekta, जैसे कि अभी बताया आपने कि सब जानते भी हैं कि टीवी इंडस्ट्री में टीवी एक्टर्स किस तरह से सीरियल्स बनते हैं और किस तरह से आपकी रेस्पेक्ट है और किस तरह से काम निकालना आपको आता है सारे एक्टर्स से. लेकिन जब आपने फिल्म में फोरे किया तो जो फिल्म इंडस्ट्री है और फिल्म जो सुपर स्टार्स हैं और स्टार्स हैं उनके विम्स एंड फैंसी पे चलती है. ऐसे बहुत सारी स्टोरीज हैं कि वो स्क्रिप्ट में भी चेंज करवाते हैं, वो ये भी तय करते हैं कि कौन होना चाहिए कौन नहीं होना चाहिए, हीरो हीरोइन से लेके बाकी एक्टर्स तक. तो जब उनके ईगोज आते हैं बीच में तो वो कैसे आपने मैनेज किया और क्या इस तरह के कुछ आपको बुरे अनुभव हुए बॉलीवुड में जब आप उनसे बड़े स्टार से डील कर रही थी?
मेरे लिए बहुत टफ हुआ पहले ये समझना कि अब आई एम नॉट द डिसाइडिंग फैक्टर, डायरेक्टर होगा. सी, लाइन प्रोड्यूसर्स एंड क्रिएटिव प्रोड्यूसर्स एंड टेलीविजन हैव द से. Suddenly it was the director, which is who's the captain of the ship in films. That itself was a big switch. Then it came into the fact that actors, they have to bite into a script and then only you can make it. So I started doing smaller films. I luckily got the chance to work with Ajay Devgan and Imran Hashmi with Once Upon a Time in Mumbai. And Ajay sir gave me a chance and he heard my story and Milan sir and Ajay sir knew each other, so it happened. But yeah, it was tough, but luckily for these few films, I got a great, I landed up making films with actors who wanted to work with me and gave me that respect. The bigger stars, I think I stayed away only because I knew that I didn't know if I would manage making those films.
Ekta, koi example aap bina naam liye share karna chahenge, kuch bure experience stars se aapko hue?
नहीं, मैं मेरे कोई बुरे एक्सपीरियंस एज सच नहीं हुए हैं एज सच, बिकॉज आई डोंट थिंक बुरे एक्सपीरियंसेस ऐसे, मतलब कि हाँ ऑफकोर्स मैंने लाइक आप नॉर्मली जब किसी बड़े स्टार को लेते हो तो आपके जो उनके जो एंटराजेस होते हैं, मैनेजर्स होते हैं, वो बड़े बुरे एक्सपीरियंस होते हैं. बिकॉज एक ही होटल में कुछ 12 रूम बुक होते हैं, उसके बाद आप टीवी से आए हो जहाँ आप एक रूम में 12 लोगों को लगाते हो सडनली उसमें आप भी होते हो सडनली इतना एक्सपेंस, इतना ऑप्युलेंस, मतलब नॉर्मली इट्स फॉर अस इट वाज अ बिग माइंड शिफ्ट, यू नो, सो दैट वाज अ बिट शॉकिंग.
थैंक यू.
आई हैड कम स्ट्रेट ऑन दिस टेबल.
Hi Ekta, Hemant over here, Hemant Sanghani.
Hi, Hemant ji.
Achha, Ekta, you are very particular about casting in your TV series.
Ji.
Yeah. And you go by some astrological or whatever you know this. Is it a fact something?
So, you know, I hear every day a new thing. Nowadays, I've started getting kundalis also on my mobile.
Yeah, yeah.
What I do, which I really want to do, say is that I check legally if actors are free or not. That's a big one for us now. Mm-hmm. Balaji has a legal cell because in daily soaps, I have cast two kids in my web show. After shooting the web show, they told us that they have signed up the daily show. So I was stuck because it was my own show. With this kind of big level of content, we do a big search on how legally they are clean or not. Because with web and TV and movies, everyone is taking small roles here and there, and then you're stuck. That one. Secondly, I cast people on instinct. Mm. When I'm seeing an audition, I'm usually tying my shoelaces by eating something, walking, and I'm doing casting. I don't even like somebody telling me that this one is that one's friend. I'm that honest to my job. And I know nobody believes that because I get so many questions on, this is a big part of the folklore. But yes, my titles are astrologically approved. My dates are astrologically approved.
Dates of what?
Dates on when to launch.
Okay, okay.
And I wear a lot of rings and they are astrologically approved. I think I'm also astrologically approved.
Because you are quite bang on when you are casting. Most of your casting is successful.
So you think it's an astrologer or it's my brains? Little credit to me.
Yeah. Because your belief in astrology makes you do the right casting for that matter. And because so you have
belief,
got a...
My belief like in said, astrology is this much that I definitely... But you know, a lot of people told me, you believe so much in astrology, why do you work so hard?
Right.
I was like, if astrologically everything worked out, then I should be sitting at home and partying and not doing any work.
Yeah, but having worked hard, you have become instinctively more accurate as such.
Yeah, so that also.
And that works as simple as that.
Yes.
Hi, ma'am. This is Poonam here.
Hi, Poonam.
Yeah, I really respect you a lot.
Thank you so much.
I follow a lot to you. Every place on your Insta, Facebook, Twitter, and wherever you go, I follow. I
stalker.
ma'am, I just wanted to know, like, whenever you have these problems and failures come, so how you tackle those things? Like, how you manage?
My dad told me something very interesting. He told me, "This too shall pass. If you're very successful, it'll pass. If you're having a horrible day, it'll pass. Life will pass. Everything changes. Badlav hi dunya ka shashwat niyam hai. So, chahe wo bad time ho ya good time ho, you cannot get stuck to the outcome. It's not in your hands. You can definitely enjoy the process. So, I don't know if Alt Balaji will be the biggest app or not. I don't care. I love the process. And as long as you stuck to the process, na, the outcome, you will look at it as reverence. With nonchalance. It doesn't matter.
That's good. Ma'am, one more question. I want to ask you that...
What is your phone number?
I sure am not getting ma'am's number. But I want to ask you, I know people talk a lot about you, that you're scaring people. People are scared from you. You are very hard rocking. You, whatever you decide, you do that. That is a passion you have in yourself. But I don't understand that after doing so many good things, actually, when you bless people, it happens good only for people. Then why people talk like this? I mean, maine suna hai ki aap jis pe bhi haath rakhte ho, uski life change ho jati hai, and that person goes aage, whatever. So you're doing all good only. You're doing all best. So why this all talks are there?
My friend, life mein na, always remember, I used to be a human being, now I'm folklore. I'm sure some of it is true. I'm human. I've made some mistakes in life. And I always believe when one person is cast, four people are abusing me because they didn't get cast. So that's life.
Hello. Hi, Ekta.
Hi,
Chaitanya here.
Hi, Chaitanya.
Yeah. Ekta, you know, just out of curiosity, you have a legendary actor, you know, your dad, Jitender. Is there a conscious decision that you do not kind of want to have a professional, you know, kind of arrangement where he works in one of your productions?
No. I asked him once, a long time ago, I said, would you want to act? And I know he likes acting. But he said something to me that he said, no, I don't want to. And I said, why? He said, no, I'm enjoying the running my business and doing my own thing. So I never pushed it. And I've constantly thought that I should offer him something and make him work. But I realized that he liked seeing himself on the big screen. And I don't know if he wants to do a daily soap. Secondly, he's not that young now. And I didn't push it, but I asked him a couple of times and he said, no, he doesn't want to act.
Has he withdrawn himself from public life in general, your dad?
No, he does go out with his friends, but he does a lot more socially. He's always like he's attending events and somebody will call him up, some old acquaintance of his whose son's function he has to go to. So he's 24/7 doing this,
right.
Attending, and it doesn't matter. For him, it's very, if he's had an old acquaintance, he's, you know, I think people of that time were like that, you know. It didn't matter that you're not working anymore with each other. He'll still go. So he actually has a far busier social life than mine also. And but he is definitely now, there's a resistance to act again. And I don't know why.
Because we've been trying to give him the Lifetime Achievement Award at the Jagran Film Festival for 3 years now. If you can please put in a word, that'll be lovely.
Of course, I'd love to see him get that.
I just did that in public. Thank you. Next one. Next question, please. Yes.
Probably it has no answer, but at what team size can one have an ever-growing empire? Like, you know, if you have a staff of 4, you can only manage 1 or 2 businesses, right? But maybe at 20 or 30 core team, you can probably have everything that you want to do.
I can't really answer this question because team size, as big as the work you're doing is, so when I was doing, I had to downsize when I was doing no show. I tried to retain all my staff at that time, but I did downsize as far as people who are freelancers. But the amount of work you do decides the size of the talent you can hire. And of course, it's a big blessing if you can hire more people. It gives buoyancy to the company.
Okay, Ekta, I have 2 questions for you. First of all, one of my friends who works in the OTT industry told me something very interesting. Domestic market mein, Secret Games has apparently, one of your shows, Kehne Ko Hamsafar, has performed 10 times better than Secret Games. Is it correct? Is this information correct?
I can't comment on anyone else's show.
But there's no way to know. Because
There's no way to know and I won't know their numbers. And I believe that, you know, there's the same audience who watches Secret Games will watch Kehne Ko Hamsafar. I really don't want to go into who's done how many numbers, you know. And we are all doing our jobs, yeah. So really, like, but I'm so happy that people watched my show and they liked it, so. I did a show which was about the other woman, which was always called the vamp on television. So I was like, happy doing it.
Yeah. Also, there's this petition in the Delhi High Court, which is about setting up a regulatory body that will censor what's going on OTT platforms. Your comment
you,
on that.
You have just scared the shit out of me.
Yeah. We'll let that pass.
Yeah, please. There has to be some expression. There has to be a place we can talk. Things that society will only change when things are spoken. Good, bad, ugly.
One last question. It's also late in the night. Yes, right there. Mike, please.
Ma'am, you have been doing soap opera in television for so many years, decades, more than a decade, and you have created so many properties, and it runs long-running properties. So they've used a lot of tropes in the shows. So in such a position, how do you come up with new ideas for your television medium if you want to continue working in that soap opera space? Where does new ideas emerge
from? So you have to innovate, not only getting new ideas, it's also, I told you, very tough because you cannot get radical on television and you're going into people's houses. So more than just getting new ideas, you have to get sometimes the socio-economic, thinking, the how social change has happened in the last couple of years into your writing. I mean, I've recently, whenever I've written a soap, I've definitely had working women. What are issues they are facing? Even if you slightly touch it, it becomes far more relatable because every time the world changes, even the most conventional stories get a whole new edge because of the way the world is changing around you.
Final question from me, and I told you I'll ask you this question. And I can only ask you this question because you're an extremely self-aware person. You can see your work very objectively from a distance. What is the most ridiculous thing you've done on TV and gotten away with it?
You want me to name one? That's damn tough, yeah?
Okay, make that 2.
Okay, so many years ago, I did this show and it was my first, I think it was a supernatural come sci-fi show. And I had to have it was episodic. So I had this episodic on Ichhadari Nagin. Of course, we later on did a lot of that, as we all know. But at that time, it was one episode, and everyone knows that budgets in Doordarshan were very small at that time. And my director suddenly on the set says, I can't shoot with a snake. I'm like, oh, I have a phobia. I'm like, oh my God, we can't cancel the shoot. She's like, I can't shoot with a snake. I'm like, but you know, when the human being converts into a snake or shapeshifts, there has to be a snake. She's like, I can't shoot with a snake. And we were not so adept in special effects at that time. So we changed the story to Ichhadari Machli. I was like, I hope none of my friends see this. I'd never hear the end of it. And it was an episode on Ichhadari Machli, which was quasi, you know, the mermaid. And it rocked television, Doordarshan. So the highest rating on the Ichhadari Machli. I got away with it. I never did it again. I'm telling you for the first time I did that. I think once when we had Smriti and Amar in Kyunki, we had them shoot Paris in Balaji. Of course, we had very stringent budgets. So we had put one Eiffel Tower outside the window, had a fireplace in summers in Bombay, given them coats. And in that arc lights, they were shooting an episode where they were saying, "Arre, itni thandi hai. Oh God, this Paris mein kitni thandi hai." I think I got away with Paris shot in Balaji was, I think, the most ridiculous thing I could do.
So what happened in the scene? So this person is looking at Paris and got tsh, 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 tsh,
suddenly,
Paris.
I mean, so in our office, we do anything. Outside the window, they had those, you know, the snow machines. Hmm. So it's a, arre, bahar itni thandi ho rahi hai. You can see the snow machine. They have a, but it worked, but we didn't have the budget. Like I told you, when for the first time I did a film and I realized that everyone has different rooms. Here we were like, lunch break mein everyone used to run down. There was one makeup van for 5 actors. The budget was 1,30,000. I remember when Star Plus called me up and we thought we got a huge budget with 90,000 to make an episode. And I got Tarun Katyal's call. Sameer Nair asked him to call me. Called my mom and my mom said, "No, Tarun, we can't make it in less than 90,000. But if you say, we'll make it in 75 because we wanted the job." Mm. And he said, "No, I'm increasing the budget to 135, but just shoot with one more camera." And we were like, 1,35,000 for an episode? I thought that suddenly, what is it? What are we going to do with the extra money?
But tell me something, and this is actually the final question. The swish pan, where twing, 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 you... Did you come up with it? Where was the first time you used it? It's become like a thing that we know television.
Darang, 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 and swish pans. So I, like you just heard, that we didn't have the budgets for great right. swipes and everything. And we wanted the audience to know there's an important moment coming. So you underline with music, darang, darang, darang. And if the woman is cooking in the kitchen, she realizes, oh God, something big happened. She comes out. And then you have those great swish pans on somebody's face. Suddenly, oh shit, huge drama. Let's sit down and watch, you know. Now, of course, we have those pullbacks and we have trolleys and we have drones. But at that time, we had one camera. We shot 22 minutes in a day.
Hmm.
And we had to do what we would call like great amount of twists and turns. And this was one formula that really worked for us. So we just continued with it. I'm telling you, necessity is the mother of all invention. If darang, darang, darang is getting the woman out of the kitchen to see the next scene, darang, darang, darang it was.
And darang, darang, darang is going to be. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Ekta Kapoor.
Srivastava to present Ekta Kapoor with a memento. Thank you once again to Ekta Kapoor for giving us such an interesting finale at the Jagran Cinema Summit. We've had a wonderful time listening into her conversation with Mayank Shekhar there. Thank you. Thank you very much.